child before the day that I met Eleanor. Kiss of the wind in the hill, the clearness of morning, the late evening thrill, blurry and gray like the road. The wheels on the highway, above them I soar. When I'm in the sweet daughter's eyes, my heart is now a ruin for the rest of all time. There's no part of it left to give. There's no part of it left to give. I never lived till I lived in your light, and my heart never beat like it does at the sight of you, baby blue. God bless it, your life. I do not live less, I live in your life. I do not live less, I live in your life. I do not live.
You gonna come see Grammy?
Yeah.
You gonna come and Well, thank you for joining us online today in support of the family. Our purpose in this time and in this service is to remember and celebrate the life of Verlin Coleman, and also, as we do that, to glorify God and to bear witness to this truth, the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Believers in Christ still experience death, and we still experience grief. And so tears are okay. They don't undermine faith at all. Jesus himself, as he's by the graveside of his good friend Lazarus, wept. Thus he freed every believer from that time on to say, it's okay to cry. But there is real hope in those tears. They aren't just tears, but they're tears with a deep, deep hope. And that hope is not an idea. It's not a philosophical reasoning. It's not positive thinking. That hope that we have is a person in Jesus Christ. And so I think it's appropriate to start by looking to what Jesus said. And so we'll look to God's word and what Jesus, the one, the only one who's conquered death, would have to say to us today. Jesus said, all those the Father gives me will come to me, and whoever comes to me, I will never drive away. For I have come down from heaven not to do my will, but to do the will of him who sent me. And this is the will of him who sent me, that I shall lose none of all those he has given me, but raise them up at the last day. For my Father's will is that everyone who looks to the Son and believes in him shall have eternal life, and I will raise them up at the last day. And Jesus said, I am the resurrection and the life, and those who believe in me, even though they die, will live. And everyone who lives and believes in me will never die. Jesus said, do not let your hearts be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. My Father's house has many rooms. If that were not so, would I have told you that I'm going there to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, that you also may be where I am. You know the way to the place where I am going. And Thomas said to him, Lord, we don't know where you are going, so how can we know the way? And Jesus answered, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you really know me, you will know my Father as well. And from now on, you do know him and have seen him. Let's pray. Our gracious God and our Heavenly Father, we give you thanks today for Verlin. We know, Lord, that you knit him together in his mother's womb, and you gave him breath and life, and you gave him as a gift to all who knew him. And Lord, you saved Verlin to eternal life by grace through his faith in your Son, Jesus Christ. And so today we recognize and cherish all the ways Verlin reflected your light, your love, your truth, and your grace. We bless your name, Lord, for welcoming Verlin into your eternal presence. And we ask in your great compassion that you give comfort to all who mourn this temporary but painful separation through death. Make us aware of your presence even now, so that this time together brings your healing and your hope and a greater trust in you. And we ask this through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The family has selected a number of songs. They're songs of hope, but they're songs of praise and worship. And so as you hear these songs, we invite you, wherever you're at, to worship along with us as we first hear Amazing Grace, My Chains Are Gone. Now I see. Now I'd like to read from Scripture, Psalm 23, words that God has given through inspiration that have helped believers for thousands of years as we've faced death. This is a Psalm of David. The Lord is my shepherd, I lack nothing. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He refreshes my soul. He guides me along the right paths for his name's sake. And even though I walk through the darkest valley, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. And surely your goodness and your love will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. I'd like to take some time to read some remembrances that the family has given me to read. And this first one is from Austin, grandson to Verlin. And Austin writes this, "Grandpa, you will be very much missed. I have so many wonderful memories to hang on to. And some of the memories I cherish most are being your hunting partner, listening to your funny jokes, but most of all, your orneriness. You were a big impact in not just my life, but also the community. Till we meet again, Austin." And then from granddaughter Brooklyn. "As I was thinking of something to write for Grandpa, it was taking me a while until I looked at the front cover of my notebook, and on it was the fruit of the Spirit. And at that moment, I was thinking to myself, that's my grandpa. So for those of you who don't know the fruit of the Spirit and are watching on livecast, this is how it begins and why I think it speaks highly of my grandpa. So I'll begin with the memories I have of my grandpa and will never forget what he did for our family. The memories I hold of my grandpa is how loved you were and how loving you were to others. The joy you brought to this family and to the community, the peace and comfort that you spoke into those who were hurt or just needed a friendly conversation, the patience you had for each one of the grandkids, the time you had to put together family vacations for all of us to be together, the kindness that you spread around the community, your goodness, gentleness, and faithfulness. Grandpa helped me in my worst moments. He always had the words to get me through my bad days, even though I may not have wanted to hear them. You always had a way with words when getting people back into a good mood, even if it was just trying to be ornery and getting them to laugh." And then these words from son-in-law Robert. This is Robert Davis. "I want to share a few thoughts about Verlin, the man the family referred to as Paco. First, it is unbelievable to me that when we consider how huge of an impact Verlin Coleman had on so many people, that we have to condense that impact down to just a few minutes. That is unfair. Sure, Verlin Coleman accomplished many, many things, but it isn't the works of Verlin that we recognize and celebrate today. It is his heart for Jesus that led him to accomplish all he did. That's what we celebrate, his servant heart. His ability to get others on board with goals he felt were important, and his organizational skills that allowed those goals to become reality, were attributes few others can claim. I witnessed time and time again his ability to let others take credit for good ideas, but he had planted that seed and sometimes even mentioned the same exact thing, and then others liked it because it was their idea. Verlin Coleman didn't care if he got the credit, only that the goal was achieved. More than once, I saw the wink in his eye when such a thing occurred. When I moved to Beloit in 2010, he was an encourager to me and my family, but he was still my father-in-law. In 2011, my father died, and Verlin soon became my father figure. But it wasn't too long that our relationship more closely resembled brothers. And I will tell you today that with the exception of my wife, he was the closest friend, my closest friend in Beloit, and I'm going to miss him a lot. But I'm so excited and happy for Verlin to be with Jesus. Sure, we're all jealous. We're selfishly wishing he was still with us, and we can't wait to go meet with him for our greatest family vacation ever." And then these words from daughter-in-law Susan. "My father-in-law, although there are many great ones, I think if I only had one word to describe him myself, it would be servant. He was always busy doing for others. You couldn't hardly beat him up from the dinner table to do the dishes, or for that matter, help prepare the food. He cooked for the kids at church every week. He served his wife, his family, his community, and he served God well. He was a wise businessman who taught his kids and grandkids the value of hard work, mostly by being an example. On the other side of that, he enjoyed life, taking the whole family, 22 of us, on vacation every 2 or 3 years because he realized that spending quality time with the family making memories was more important than accumulating wealth here on earth. I watched, listened, and learned from him more than he ever knew, a true gentle giant. Well done, thy good and faithful servant. Enter into your rest. I'll have some more family remembrances in just a moment, but we want to take time for our next song of praise. This is Amazing Love, You Are My King.
My joy to all of you.
Now I have some other family remembrances. This from Verlin's son, Heath. Heath writes, "Verlin, my dad, was a great example of steadfast godliness. Growing up, he was always there at breakfast and supper with us. He loved our mom, loved our kids. He enjoyed his work and projects, and he challenged us to excel in life. He was faithful with the church community and always made excellent use of the blank spaces in the church bulletins for doing a little God-ordained doodling and planning. He was a patient dad and seldom got angry and was lighthearted about most things. When I was 14, I asked him if I could get a .22 rifle. I'm pretty sure he said yes, and so I ordered it from Sears, might have got my sister to sign for it, and rode my bike home with it a few weeks later. And when he saw it, he said with a little surprise, 'Who told you that you could buy that?' And I said, 'You did.' And he replied, 'I see.' And that was the last he questioned on it, and I still have that .22. He instilled in me a love for planning, projects, camping, travel, and yard work. I can't be too downhearted about him going to his rest, as he invested so much in me over the years and was a shining example of fatherhood. I bless my earthly father, Verlin Coleman, and my mother. May God's gracious face shine upon them, both here and beyond." And our next remembrance comes from Verlin's son, Brett, who made this video to share.
Hi, I'm Brett Coleman. I'm Verlin Coleman's oldest son. And I'm married to Susan Coleman. We live in Lee Summit, Missouri. My son, Alec, lives in Tulsa. And my daughter is in Kansas City. She has one more year of architecture school left. And we're here to celebrate my dad and talk a little bit about my memories of him. I didn't know him as a coach like my sisters did. My sisters are 10 and 6 years older than me, and he used to coach when he was at Spearville and Jetmore. And my earliest memories of dad is more as a principal. And so I was a PK, a principal's kid. And for me, that meant some good things, like if I said something I shouldn't have said to a kid that was older or bigger than me, and I was afraid I was going to get beat up, I would just go sit down by my dad, and I always felt safe. So if my mouth wrote a check I couldn't cash, he was always there for me. But that also meant that, like, if my friends and I planned to sneak off sometime, my dad usually knew the plan before I came home from dinner. He usually knew it better than I did. And I could never say the teachers were at fault or to be blamed, because he didn't believe that. He always gave the teachers the benefit of the doubt. So there was advantages and disadvantages to being a principal's kids. Some of the things I remember about my dad is he liked to have fun. He lived a very balanced life. So he liked to have fun, but he liked to work hard. And for fun, we'd play cards. Of course, most of the time it was Brett, my brother-in-law, Jay, Denise's husband, against Dad and my brother-in-law, Robert. Of course, Jay and I won almost all those games. There was a big debate about who was the champion of the world in pitch. And every Christmas and every time we got together, we would debate that and have a lot of fun playing cards. Dad also liked to fish. We'd go to Gunnison, Colorado when we were young, camp, fish, hike those trails. He liked to farm. My dad loved farming, and it was almost as one of his joys. He grew up on a farm, and that was really probably his first love. And his first big adventure in that was a Christmas tree farm. And my brother and I would hoe the Christmas trees 2 or 3 nights a week. We'd mow the Christmas trees, and then when they grew up, we'd sell them, we'd shake them, we'd trim them, we'd shape them. And the Christmas tree farm was, I think, one of the big adventures that Dad had. And when we graduated from high school, got married, the Christmas tree farm eventually got sold, because I think he realized that his labor, and he paid us well, but his labor had disappeared. And so I think that was a big reason he sold the Christmas tree farm. But he loved that. He loved to give a tree away to someone that even if they couldn't afford it. My dad was always a fan of the underdog. He'd help people get into a house even when they couldn't afford to buy it. And he treated people with the utmost kindness and respect, no matter their position in life. I think it's partially because when he was growing up, he would skip school. And he would skip school. He got brought into the principal's office. Why'd you skip school? And he said, I had to go hunting for meat for the family. And so he understood what it was like to be underprivileged. And so he always had a soft spot in his heart for the underdog. And I think he passed that down to all of us kids. We would go hunting, Heath and I, and we would do a little parish and some of our other friends, Dean, and we would go hunting, and sometimes when we didn't see anything in the field, we would just drive the roads looking for birds, and it was a great time to talk and to think about things, dream about ideas, and Dad always had lots of ideas. We always had lots of ideas, and it was a great time to think about what the future was gonna be like. And the hunting was progressively got worse and worse because the farming got better and better, and there was fewer and fewer pheasants, but we had a lot of fun doing it, and we always found time to take an afternoon nap. Even when we worked on Saturdays and every Saturday was a work day, we always found time for an afternoon nap, and I still hold that dear in my heart today. So Dad liked to have fun. He liked to work hard. He put his family, was very important to him. He helped each one of his grandkids with their college tuition. That was sort of the Coleman scholarship that was, you didn't really know you were gonna get it until you were in school. So it was kind of a neat thing he did. Mom was obviously number one on his priority. And there was never playing the two against each other. They always, you couldn't divide and conquer. They knew that game. And they were always working together. And my son told me that when my dad went to Tulsa just about a month ago, and he and Mom were there, and Alec was telling him about some troubles he was having with a girl, my dad just kind of grinned. He said, they're trainable. Of course, we know that's not true, but he tried. And so we love you, Mom. Dad tried to train you. They had a great relationship. And I think it was amazing. We would have breakfast every morning together as a family. We had dinner every night together as a family. My dad came to every football game I ever played in, every basketball game I ever played in, and every track meet I was ever in. He never missed a single one of any of the kids. And so he was committed to the family. He was committed to the grandkids. I think everyone pretty much agrees unanimously that grandkids are more fun than kids because you can send them home. But he loved his grandkids and now his great-grandkids. So he had a lot of fun. He loved his family. He never made more than $60,000 a year, and yet he died a millionaire plus. And I think that just shows what steady financial faithfulness does. He always had, eight to five is when you make a living, five to eight is when you make your life. And Dad always had an extra project, a rental project or a remodel. He loved to work with his hands. And I did not gain that from him. All that hard manual labor made me glad I was in college and made me look forward to going back to college every year. So he was a great father in terms of how he treated his family, how he was loyal to his family. He had a great faith. He loved the Lord. Mom and Dad went to church. They made sure we went to church. There was no opting out of church when I was a kid. Sometimes we'd stay in bed hoping they wouldn't wake up, but they always woke up and we went to church. And now I will say in church, sometimes there were some football plays that I saw drawn on the handout for the day. So Dad might draw a football play or two while he was in church, but you always went to church. And he wasn't a preachy kind of faith person. He walked it out. He didn't talk it out, he walked it out. And I respect that. That's the way I want to be too. There's a verse in Proverbs chapter 21:5 that says, good planning and hard work lead to prosperity, but hasty shortcuts lead to poverty. And that really describes my dad's way that he went about life. He just every day, little by little, did the right thing. It was never any day. It wasn't flashy. It wasn't big moves. It wasn't big speeches. It was just little consistent faithfulness over a long, long period of time, and it added up. And if there's anything that I take away as much as anything, is it's like what little faithfulness does every single day in your relationships, in your marriage, in your church, in your finances. Little faithfulness every single day. If you do that for 83 years, I think there's a big reward at the end. For my dad passing away at 83, I'm totally flabbergasted because he's a young 83. And he was an energetic 83. He loved to travel. He and I got to go to Alaska together and go on a couple of cruises together. And we just got to do so many fun things as we were getting older and both of us as adults. It was just a great time to spend with my dad in these last years. And so I will dearly miss those times. For us, it's a sad ending. For Dad, it's a happy beginning. And we love you, Dad, and we are thankful for the house you provided us, the home, and the life that you provided us, and the example that you set. And we look forward to be reunited with you in the future someday. Love you, Dad. Brett.
And now we'll have a remembrance from Berlin's daughter, Denise. This is an audio recording that she shared with us.
I want to tell you a little bit about my dad. I was very fortunate to have a father whose actions and words would constantly reveal a heavenly father. One of my youngest memories was a stormy night in western Kansas. At 3 years old, he grabbed me up and we sat on the front porch in a rocking chair. Me on his lap, him pointing to the great lightning strikes and marveling at the majesty. What I didn't really understand at the time was how deathly afraid my mother was of storms and how my earthly father was trying to protect me from that fear, just as our heavenly father tries to protect us from fear. Another time, my dad gave my sister and I a job of pulling weeds. He said he would pay us a penny apiece. Well, we went to town on that patch beside the driveway. I came in a little while later and told him I'd picked 237 weeds. He looked shocked, but paid the money. Shortly after that, we got an allowance of $1 a week. On a piece of paper in his distinct handwriting, he had written a budget, which he explained to his 4-year-old and 7-year-old daughters. 10 cents to the church, 10 cents to savings, and the rest to do what you want, although it was okay to save more. That lesson came full circle when my husband and I, with 3 small children of our own, and very little income, decided to trust the wisdom that not only came from my father, but was also in the Bible. Slowly but surely, our Heavenly Father got us out of our financial struggle. Us kids always saw Mom and Dad being loving to each other, spontaneously laughing, kissing, or dancing. Every summer, American Bandstand would have a dance contest. Our family would be huddled around the TV, dancing to the songs. Dad and Mom teaching us that our Heavenly Father is filled with joy and love for each other, and the beginning of an understanding of the commitment to a marriage vow. No one would believe this story was about my dad if I didn't mention working with him. Dad always had a job planned. Vanette and I were his oldest kids, so there was never a question of who would help with these projects. Many of them involved painting. However, I remember one particular project when we moved to Beloit, where we tore down the lathe and cement walls to remodel the house. His 100-pound girls were trying to swing hammers and wheelbarrow chunks of the wall side by side with him. He used to always say, "You need to have a ditch digger's job so you know you don't want to be a ditch digger." He definitely made it very appealing to get an education and not to be a ditch digger. However, as we got older and we had our education, he made work a lot more fun. For a long time, I thought my earthly father was a hard taskmaster, until I paid bills myself and thought of my father's childhood. He was a farmer's son. He told stories of how you could eat a spring chicken that tasted so good, but by the time the chickens were old and tough, you were sick of chicken. He also told of wearing flour sack shirts to college in a town of city slickers. My dad knew that hard work and education would take you out of poverty. My perception of his hardness was actually a deep love and desire to protect us from a life of real hardship. And another lesson was born. God may seem harsh, but if you look closer, he's trying to save you from pain and difficulty. One of the biggest lessons my earthly father had to teach me was about unconditional love and grace. For a long period of time, I chose a difficult path, one that eventually led me to spend the weekend in jail. When I called home, Mom and Dad came immediately. I was expecting a long lecture and much disappointment. Instead, my dad sent me a letter. He said a lot of wise things, but one thing that stuck out was, "The world needs a Denise." His grace and love, demonstrated in a dark time, was a seed that began to grow and move me into a new path. Later, when I started reading the Bible and saw the verse, "It is his kindness that leads to repentance," I knew of that firsthand. As I grew older, no matter where I lived, you could call and ask Dad how to do something, and he seemed to know how, providing the understanding that we have a Heavenly Father who wants us to speak to him about the big and the little things. Because of my mom and dad's faith in God, all of us are believers. Our last lesson our Heavenly Father gave us through Dad started when Dad got sick. We banded together and prayed. We believed with all our hearts Dad would be healed. Some might say, why wasn't he? I believe this gave us a chance to come together and lean on God, so that even if Dad was gone, we would rely on the Heavenly Father he was always trying to imitate. We have a Heavenly Father who doesn't want us to worry about our needs or our future, and he invites each one of us to come in the simplest of ways. His son died because of our imperfections, and we just take that first step to believe in him and the sacrifice of Jesus and not in ourselves or man. My dad wasn't always a man of many words, but I know he would have wanted each of you to know the hope of salvation through God's Son.
And then we have this remembrance written by Verlin's daughter, Vinette. My earliest memories of my dad are playing and having fun. Dad would chase you through the house as you shrieked. We would dogpile on Mom and Dad as they slept in bed. Dad was the master at playing possum and would surprise us as we prepared for attack. He was a father who was involved as a parent. I had no skill with any sports involving a ball. It did not keep him from signing up to be the girls' softball coach when I was young. He would help me practice batting and pitching. He started a summer recreation program in Jetmore. Every weekday morning from 8 a.m. to noon, he had activities for kids. The games were fun. Dad wore a funny hat with holes and was always telling humorous stories. When my dad taught industrial arts, he would take Denise and I to the shop on Saturday mornings. We would take the air hose and blow the sawdust around on the floor. We didn't know we were helping him clean. We just thought we were having fun. I thought my dad was the most important man around. He coached football, basketball, baseball, and track. And I remember looking at the baseball diamond and football field and thinking how big they were. All I knew was that they were big, and if my dad went there, lots of other people would come. And I thought I was really lucky because my dad controlled the whole thing, and he could take us there anytime. I remember our family vacations. When we went to Gunnison, Colorado, Dad went to school also. I don't know when he studied, because he also seemed to have time to do things with the family. And sometimes I would get up with him at 5 o'clock in the morning to go fishing in the Gunnison River. And Dad would always put a rock on his pole and lean back and take a nap. We'd nap, fish, and sometimes catch something. We might have caught more fish without the naps, but it sure made fishing nice and relaxing. When we hiked up to the beaver ponds in Colorado, we would stand on the beaver dam to fish. And one year I caught a really big fish. My dad jumped in the water with his net because he didn't want it to get away. And it was hard to tell who was most excited. My mom, because my dad jumped in the water, or my dad giving me instructions to reel in the fish. Dad worked hard. Saturday mornings were not for sleeping in. Every weekend, there were projects to do. He never asked anyone to do something that he wouldn't do himself. Our family was always full of laughter. Beyond the family vacations, Dad was a big joker. He loved to see if he could get my mom to fall for whatever he had up his sleeve. He would look around the table with a twinkle in his eye to get our attention so that we were watching to see what he was going to do next. And then he would lay out the bait for Mom and wait for her to run with it. When Austin was young, he saw this. He said, "Is there popcorn with this movie?" And Dad caught on right away and said, "What movie?" And Austin came right back, "Tom and Jerry." And Dad asked, "Who am I?" And Austin retorted, "Tom." That was Dad, always adding a little spark and humor wherever he went. My greatest blessing in moving to Beloit is the privilege of seeing my dad almost every day. He would walk down the street and stop in our office. It was the casual, everyday interactions that have helped me to store up a lifetime of memories. His wisdom, his humor, and his teasing will all be sorely missed. And now let's worship God with this next song, "It Is Well."
With me.
Well, I just want to thank the family for all these remembrances, which are beautiful and I think powerful. Because when we remember Verlin and we remember every moment where we really felt loved, where we really felt something really special, I know that that was actually Verlin drawing on the only source of love that there is in this universe, and that is God. God is love. And so God loving us through Verlin, it's really powerful. I have a few memories of my own of Verlin. Just some beautiful thoughts in my mind of little everyday kinds of things. Just his dedication, his commitment to being here, to being involved in the Lord's church, and working in people's lives, worshiping together. And so I'm always going to be thinking of where Diane and Verlin sit and worship. I didn't know he was such a good doodler during worship, so I wish he had shown me some of those doodles, but it's a great memory just to see him worshiping. And it always seemed to me, and somebody mentioned this in one of their remembrances, that he always had, it seemed like a twinkle in his eye. And it, when somebody put that in a remembrance, like, yeah, it always seemed to me that Verlin knew something that I didn't. And so, but it was never a dread. Some people know something you don't, and then you kind of dread that they're going to use it against you. But I always knew. I felt comfortable always in Verlin's presence because I knew if he knew something I didn't, he was either going to spin it for good or it was for good in some way. And so just for my own personal sense, and just Diane and Verlin, regular in my Sunday morning life group class that we have here at the church, and him always being a part of it, always sitting in one spot. He kind of had his favorite spot there as well. But we'd have good discussion in that class a number of times, and Verlin would participate. He would share sometimes, but a lot of times Verlin would come to me right after the class was over. And then he would come up and then he would share something with me. Hey, I was thinking about this, or here's something to consider, and here's a question I had. And I said, Verlin, you know, feel free to share that in class, because if you're thinking it, I know, you know, most of the other people are thinking it as well. And he said to me, you know, that we had good discussion and I didn't want to take away. I didn't want to take away from anybody else's chance to share. And I just thought that was a beautiful expression. I'll always remember him as being the master in charge for CLASH or VBS meals when, you know, especially when there are more students than we expected. So, you know, you get over 100 hungry elementary students that show up, and Verlin was in charge of the food and the meals, and he did a masterful job. But sometimes you have more kids than you expected, and so everybody else, we're all kind of freaking out a little bit, like, how are we going to, they outnumber us and they're hungry, and what are we going to do? And Verlin just always was cool as a cucumber. And if that meant you had to throw some leftover hot dogs in the pasta, then so be it, but we're going to make sure that they're fed. And just always appreciated the way that he had this just confidence that, hey, God's got this. I know that you shared with me, Verlin wrote a letter just 2 years ago to his grandchildren, and it's a beautiful, beautiful letter. And how thoughtful that Verlin is thinking ahead, legacy-wise here. I want to leave something for my grandkids. And he wrote this letter. I'm not going to read the whole thing, but there were just highlights in there that I wanted to kind of pull out, because I think they really express well what we have seen as a testimony to Verlin's life. One of the things he wrote in there to his grandchildren was, I have been blessed with a great life and a great marriage, and I want to impart a few thoughts to you. And so the fact that he uses the word blessed, he's saying, I know that this life and this marriage and my family are given to me. To be blessed means you know that there's someone who's doing the blessing. And here he is saying, I know I didn't create this, I didn't manage this, I didn't make this on my own, but I've been blessed. And then his first thought is, I want to impart. So he follows that very truth that Jesus, you know, brought about, that freely we have received, so freely we give. And I thought that just highlighted Verlin's life. In the letter, he referred to an article that he wanted his grandchildren to read. The article was entitled The Power of Delaying Gratification, which he said is really crucial if we're going to keep our eyes on heaven. To delay gratification, Verlin wanted them and us and everyone to know there is much more to this life than the number of years that we have in our bodies. In the light of eternity, things that seem important now kind of fade away. But some things that seem small and insignificant, they loom large in light of eternity. And Berlin was trying to point us to, that's the thing you want to keep your eye on. Berlin had this humility, and in the letter he expressed it. He said in the letter, I have made my fair share of mistakes. And living out, when he was trying to live out delayed gratification for himself, he said, it's been difficult for me, as most often I was chasing fun, money, work, and family, and not necessarily the goal of heaven. Berlin confessed, he said, I have a very strong individual spirit that had to be overcome. And it's a beautiful thing when someone who's lived so many years and done them well is still able to say, and yet I'm a sinner and I fall short. And to confess that, I think, is helpful, really important. It's true for all of us. At the very core of our lives is this human sin that Berlin puts it, it's a very strong individual spirit. We could call it pride, this sense that I can do it on my own. I can live independent from God, even though we are created and we're fully dependent on Him. And Berlin felt like, you know what, this is something that you have to overcome, and the only way to overcome it is through the power of the Holy Spirit. And so Berlin is pointing us to this, fight against this and receive Christ. To receive Christ is to surrender. It's really to surrender that pride. Berlin prayed. In the letter he wrote that he asked God, and I love this phrasing, he said on various occasions when he wanted something, he had a desire for something, but he prayed, God, either bless or block this. Either bless or block this, that I know what I want, but I want what you want. And I think in one case he mentioned in the letter it was about his trying to sell his wheat, and the price that he was shooting for, it was not going for at all, and he was getting a little concerned about it. But he said, at one point, he said, I told God that it was his wheat, which gave me a great peace of mind, he said. And then it turned out that over time, that price actually rose above the price that he wanted. And so he saw the blessing of God in surrendering and letting go. But he also was honest enough to say this about prayer. We don't always get the answer to prayer that we want. And so he shared in that letter how he prayed when his dad got cancer. And he prayed that God would bring healing to his dad. But the answer was no in that case. And Berlin very honestly said, it shattered my faith until I accepted the sovereignty of God. That's a profound lesson. I mean, that's really a deep lesson where he says, you know, prayer is not about always getting what I want. Sometimes the answer, he said, was no. Sometimes he said it was delayed. And sometimes the answer is not seen by human eyes or understood by man. But on all of that, he said, you keep praying because this too builds our faith. Wonderful expression of truth. I think you can only put that kind of trust in God if you first experience how much God loves you. When God loves you so deeply, then you can trust. I don't think we can trust until we know God's love first. And that tells me Berlin knew God's love. He knew it so deeply that even when his heart was hurting and crushed, he could say, yet I hold to God. He is true and he is good. He wrote, the love of God invites you to heaven, and it will be the ultimate family vacation, date unknown. And I know you shared that with me early on after Berlin passed, and it just strikes me again, just this truth. Yeah, there is much more than what we see in this life. And to know this great hope, not even death can steal this away. This is true. We're going to be together. We're going to have this great family time of vacation, date unknown. You mentioned a couple of scripture passages. Let me just mention a few of these. Psalm 116, verse 15 says, precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his faithful servants. Precious in the sight of the Lord was Verlin's death, because he was his servant. And of course, God's love for his servant was so strong that this was a precious moment, heart-wrenching for us, but precious in the sight of the Lord. And Ecclesiastes 7:1, which says, "For those that are in Christ, the day of death is better than the day of birth." How can the day of death be better than our day of birth? Well, if you know this love of God, that love that is not even death can separate us from the love of God. So if you know that love, then the day of our death becomes celebration. It becomes this moment of recognizing, now I come into the presence of the one who has always loved me. And then to hear those words. So you mentioned one other scripture. Let me just focus on that just for a bit. In Matthew 25, Jesus gives a number of parables, and three parables in a row, and the middle one of those has a verse that you chose from, Matthew 25, 21. And we hear this a lot at funerals, but there's a reason that it really holds true and means a lot in these moments, and that's because the words are this, that at one point the Savior will say, "Well done, good and faithful servant." And it comes in the middle of this parable, which is sometimes called the parable of the talents, which is that a wealthy master, gives large sums of money to three of his servants. And in that time, in that culture, servants were not just slaves. They were able actually to make a living and invest and actually really benefit if they had a master who was good and a master who was generous. And this parable tells us this was the most generous of masters. It would be like Bill Gates coming to us and saying, "I'm entrusting with you $100 million. And to have that kind of wealth given to his servants, the master does this for three of his servants. And two of his servants, in great joy, go out right away and they begin to invest it and use it. And the third one does not. The third servant, he buries it. And the whole parable is not about how much they make, because in fact, the first two servants get the exact same reply. One doubles his investment from 5 to 10, the other doubles it from 2 to 4, but they both get the exact same reply. "Well done, good and faithful servant," when the master comes back. And the whole parable is really not about the amounts, it's about the heart. Because the third servant, he said, "The reason I didn't do anything is because I didn't trust you. I didn't believe you were good. You're always, in my mind, getting what you don't deserve." And so this servant, who mistrusted his master, just buried it, and his life became very shriveled, very small. But the other ones, it reveals the exact opposite. What it really says is they said, "Oh, I know you're good. You've blessed me, and I don't even deserve it." And so when they go out and they begin to take what is given to them and utilize it for the glory and the good of the master, they get good and they get the joy. God is our master who blesses us all in different ways, but he is good and he's always generous. And we are either going to live this life in such a way that we recognize that God is good and loves us, or we will mistrust God. And then we'll live in resentment and fear and defiance. But I believe this, no matter who we are, I think there's a part of us that longs to hear, "Well done, good and faithful servant." I think it's so deep in us, I actually think we chase that for most of our lives. We do. We need to hear that. We want to hear it. And so we will look for it from parents and from siblings and from spouses and from friends and from teachers and from coaches and from bosses and from supervisors. And even if we get it from them, "Hey, good job, well done," it doesn't seem to last. And I think this is all a sign that's saying, no, we were actually created, we were made to hear our Heavenly Father say, "Well done, good." That's what we've been looking for the whole time. I think Berlin found it. I know he did. And I know that he has heard, "Well done, good and faithful servant." It's our Lord, it's our Master. We can trust his "well done." When he says it, it's going to last, because his love is beyond even our greatest worst failures, not our best. He loved us when we were at our worst, not our best. He loved us before we were able to serve him in any way. And so when he says, "Well done, good and faithful servant," that's a love that is sure and is not dependent on my performance or how well I can do anything. But now with that joy, I'm able to serve in ways I could not before. As you remember Verlin, I hope that you will see that the love and the grace that you experienced through his life was actually drawn from the love and the grace of God. And that longing that we all have is available to every one of us in Jesus Christ. I know the family, we've talked, and you would have no greater joy that in Verlin's life that he would draw people to Jesus, and that in Verlin's death he would draw people to Jesus. I know that's on your heart. Your greatest joy would be for that to happen. And that can happen even now. Even if you're watching and listening this afternoon, you can receive that, well done, good and faithful servant, not by what you do, but by laying down our pride, surrendering. And so I would like to close this time just with offering a prayer. And this is a prayer that you can pray along with me. If your heart is there and wants to do that, we certainly don't want to coerce or manipulate anybody, but I know this is on the heart of the family, and I know it was on Verlin's heart all the time. And so let me just offer this prayer, and you can pray along. If this is your heart's desire, you can pray with me. God, have mercy on me, a sinner, because I know that I cannot save myself from the consequences of my sin. Thank you for demonstrating your love for me through the sacrificial death of your Son. I accept your grace alone for the forgiveness of my sins and a new life as a child of God. Free me to find my greatest joy in trusting you as my Savior and Lord. Fill me with your Holy Spirit. Give me a new heart with new desires, a renewed mind that holds to the truth, and a strong commitment to walk with you all of my days. Because you first loved me, move me to walk with you each day, to love you with all my heart, soul, mind, and strength, and to love my neighbor as I love myself. Thank you for making me a new creation in this very moment. In Jesus' name, amen. And we're going to close with one more praise song, but I would just ask, if you just prayed that prayer, could I just encourage you to do one more thing? Would you just tell somebody? Because that's something that's so, you'll be blessed if you share that you have in fact surrendered and given your life to Christ. And Verlin will be jumping. He'll be jumping for joy. I know at that. So let's worship God with this last song, which I believe the lyrics to this song are actually expressing what Verlin is doing even now. So let's worship God.
Will be
just close with this benediction. My prayer is that the strong love of the Father would be your firm foundation. I pray that the grace of His Son, Jesus Christ, would fill you up to overflowing. And I pray that the presence and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit would be with you now and forever. Amen.